for power, riches, or fame. Oh, 'cause my God is so much better than all of these things. So I won't be shaken, I won't be moved. My God is faithful, His promise is true. So I'll speak to the mountains. Oh, it's time to move, 'cause my God is bigger, better, stronger, greater. My enemies scatter, 'cause they know the battle is done. My God is stronger, the victory's already won. Yeah, He died for my ransom and rose up on the third day.
Welcome to Fairmount. We are glad that you are here this morning on this sunny, cold, wintry day. Thank you for getting up and coming in to worship this morning. We welcome those that are also joining us online this morning and glad that you are with us as well. I just want to give you a couple quick announcements before we get started. First off, the Niños trip meeting, Niños to Mexico trip meeting that was supposed to be last week was postponed last week because the weather has been rescheduled for next Sunday, January 30th, right after after this service. So if you're interested in going to Mexico with our group next Sunday, you can find out all the information about that. College students' care packages. We are collecting goods through next week to send to our college students. If we don't have a student's address, please get that to us. We want to be able to just show them a little bit of love and make sure they know that their church is thinking about them while they're at school. And then the last thing I want to share with you this morning is our baby bottle campaign continues today. That kicked off last week. You can pick up a bottle out in the lobby, take it home, fill it up with change, bring it back. All of those funds will go to assist the Pregnancy Resource Center. Those are the announcements I have, but I have Eric Taylor here, one of our elders, and he's going to give you one more announcement this morning.
Thank you, Chris. All right, I'd like to give you an update on our Onward Christmas campaign program that we have each year and our giving in that. But first, I want you to find the seatbelt on your chair and just make sure you are ready for the message that Seth will be delivering to you today. It is powerful. I was just telling Chris, anytime we get into the book of Acts, and redemption and how you can deliver the message to those outside of Christ, it is always powerful. So be ready for that. Speaking with our giving campaign, we've talked about unity, we've talked about sacrificial giving, and I just want to talk a little bit about in Matthew 6, early on Jesus, the beginning of the chapter, he's talking about you're doing your righteous acts, and I'm paraphrasing, humbly, okay? And right after that, in verse 2, he talks about giving. And he doesn't talk about if you feel like giving, if you give. Jesus says in red letters, when you give. And our church has been fantastic about giving. And so thank you. Thank each of you for all of your contributions to the campaign and the blessings that it's going to bestow on way more than the College Ministries of Virginia. Diego and Claudia Sylvia. They will be back very soon with us, and they're going to start an international ministry group with VCU. Josh Smith has explained, too, there'll be other church plants happening as well. So you're giving, not only we're reducing our debt for the church, okay, we're going to give a powerful gift to College Ministries of Virginia. We have about a week to go, okay, and our numbers right now, we are at $388,000. So please do. That is absolutely fantastic. Our goal of 350, we got a week to go, and I don't know if you're like me, I love round numbers. I'm hoping, I would love to hit $400,000, and Josh's team with a check for $40,000, wouldn't that be a blessing? Speaking of blessings, let's go to our Lord. Father God, thank you so much. Thank you for the generous giving, and thank you for the powerful message that you deliver through those you have chosen. And thank you so much, Father, for forgiveness of sins, and thank you for your son, Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Why don't you go ahead and stand up and worship with us this morning?
Safe within your name, this sweet. shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, broken every chain.
Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Freedom is ours when we call His name. Jesus' name.
Jesus' name will break every stronghold. Freedom is ours when we call His name. Jesus' name above every other. All hail the power of Jesus' name. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Strong enough to save. Rise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every
never final when the Father's in the room. shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the sinful find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Ooh, lay your burdens. Father's house, check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Amen, amen. God, we thank you so much for the chance to be in your house this morning, that our shame, our guilt, our sin, our pain, it all melts away. You have bought our forgiveness. You have cleansed us of all of our sin. All the things that we've done, they don't matter anymore. And they're not welcome right now, God, that all is about you. All of this is for you. God, we bring you glory this morning. We seek to bring you glory in everything that we do, everything that we are. We lift you up. You're the great healer. You're the great physician, God. You are everything. You are our everything, God. You are our Savior, an awesome God, our Creator. And we humble ourselves before you this morning. We please, God, open our hearts and our minds to the message we're about to receive. And we thank you so much for all that you've done and all that you will do. Thank you for being with us this morning, God, in such a powerful way. In Jesus' name. Amen.
All God's people said amen. Thank you, CJ, for showing the love of Jesus and leading us today. Can I get a big hand from the body of Christ? Amen. So I'm not sure exactly what the songwriter was thinking when he said the Father's house. I know that what we could do is we could imagine that maybe this building is the Father's house, or somehow that he inhabits a building, but I'd rather see that the Father's house is our building, right? Our bodies. He inhabits this house. And to welcome him into this house and to say that this body, as far out as it may seem to be, is really the most important body on the planet, the body of Christ. Amen? So turn to your neighbor and say, I'm really glad you're here. I'm really glad you're here. And then you could say, we need you. We need you. Yeah, you really said it convincingly. It's early, I know. Did somebody say it's early? At 11:15, it's early. 11:30. So we are in the series on unity, and the series on unity today specifically is on being committed in unity. And the part of being committed in the unity of the body of Christ is that in our text of Ephesians, and we've been moving through Ephesians in fast order of this fourth chapter, specifically talking today about the unity that needs to happen, the unity that needs to be displayed in the body of Christ. So the unity and the commitment of which we're preaching on today out of Ephesians chapter 4, specifically in your scripture, which is the Word of God, according to the half-brother of Jesus in the book of James, James would say this, that the scripture, your Bible, is a mirror, and that idea that you're going to look into the mirror, and the goal is that as you look into the mirror, and if you see something that isn't what it's intended to be, that instead of just looking at yourself in the mirror of God's Word and then walking away and forgetting what that is, then you're going to be more of a doer than just a reader of the Word. You want to do the Word. And James, in his practical book on Christianity, the book of James, great book that you should read, reminds us that the Scripture is a mirror, and we want to look at it. And if there's anything that needs to change, then by God's help, by the power of prayer, by the presence of the Holy Spirit that enters your life and seals you as being His kid, when you confess Him and you repent of your sins and you're baptized into Christ, He puts His Spirit inside of you. And even now, I love what it says when it says that even now Christ is interceding on behalf of those that are His body, His house. And so there's everything that I believe that God has done to prepare us to be the body of Christ. He has prepared us to be the house where He is the Father of the house. And the goal is always to get together and encourage each other for a little while, and then we're just going to go out and say, okay, we desire to be that. We want to be the body of Christ. We want to be unified in the body of Christ. We want to be committed to that body of Christ. So Jesus prayed for that, and Rick was good enough to point that out a couple of times over the last 3 weeks, that Jesus prayed the fact that we would be one, and then He qualified that. He said that the quality of unity is when we're united with God up and down the vertical, and then we're united with our brothers the horizontal. So there's always a lot of work that is going on behind the scenes, even now in a world that is trying to bring people together and trying to have lots of unity together in people's lives, forgetting that the unity that Paul is talking about, the unity that we need in our life, isn't just a unity on the horizontal, the idea of this unity in the vertical. And you can't have unity on the horizontal if you don't have vertical unity with God. So I have to really be careful about what I chase after, because if I'm chasing after this unity that comes horizontal without the vertical, you can't do that. It's not possible. And the church knows that. So Jesus prayed for it. And then we'll say the Apostle Paul, when it came to things that he preached about, he preached a lot about unity. In fact, right now, Lord willing, you know this, that it isn't just here in Ephesians chapter 4. Paul talked about it in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and then Romans chapter 12. He will spend a lot of time in his preaching about the body of Christ, how important the body of Christ is, how it is important in the body of Christ that if you find a lesser member of the body of Christ, that person is even more important because it demands from you to be more like Jesus. And the idea that we don't look at body members in the body of Christ as being lesser. We don't look at them as being insignificant. And even in our eyes, if we thought that they were insignificant, they are not. They are actually more important. And so out of that is the beauty of what Paul said, and he said a lot about it. Actually, Paul accredited for writing about 13, if not 14, books of the New Testament. So even if you're a young Christian or you're just starting in your walk with Christ and you started reading in the New Testament, chances are you're going to stumble across Paul. And remember that this was actually one of his favorite subjects. I say that, and then you know this, if you know your Bible, about Paul, that there was a time his name was Saul, and that in the early part of his life, he spent most of the early part of his life trying to divide the church. He spent most of his time early on in his life trying to obliterate the church. He spent most of his time trying to annihilate the church. And that's what makes his words so down to earth, heartfelt today when he talks about the importance of the unity. Acts chapter 8, if you remember the story, Acts chapter 8 in verse 1 has this picture of a young Saul before he's Paul. Young Saul is standing there while Stephen is being killed, as we tend to believe, you know, like the first martyr for the faith, the first one that died for Jesus. And it's like Paul, then Saul, was handing the rocks and say, yeah, let's kill him. Acts chapter 9, he is on his way to Damascus. That is not a short journey. That's a very long journey north. And he is going there, and he's going to Damascus, and he has letters in his hands. He knows who they are, and he's going to arrest them and bring them back to Jerusalem to be tried. He is dividing the body. He's against the body. If you remember the story, and it is recorded there in Acts chapter 9, there's this great light, he's blinded, and out of the light comes the voice, and it is the voice of Jesus. And he says, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Why? And that language is interesting. Why are you persecuting me? Because the idea is that when you are persecuting the church, you are persecuting Jesus himself. And I'm always humbled by that, because about the moment that I am tempted to give commentary on somebody that is a member or is actually the body of Christ himself, then I had to be really careful about that. In fact, it would be better for me not to say anything at all about the body of Christ, because when I'm talking about the body of Christ, I'm talking about Jesus. It actually even gets more severe when you get to Matthew 25, and it says, you remember when I was hungry, do you remember when I was naked, remember when I was a stranger, remember all of that, and when did you help me? Well, when did we see you? He said, well, when you did it to the least of my brethren, you did it unto me. There is this consciousness of the Lord Jesus Christ that what you say and what you do reflects on him, because you are, as according to what this scripture says, the body of Christ. And out of that, it brings, we would hope, a new chapter in our life today. And it did bring a new chapter in the life of Paul, because when he was Saul, God sent Ananias to him and said, this is what God wants you to do, Saul. He says, as Ananias was told by the Lord, it said, go to this man. He's going to be my chosen vessel to carry my name to the Gentiles, to their kings, and before the people of Israel. The idea is that God had chosen to give Saul a second chance. God had chosen to give Saul a new chapter in his life. And I wonder, because we all do this, and I do this, we do the routine every Sunday, and if I'm not careful, I forget that there may be an open door here. There may be an open opportunity here, and the open opportunity is to have a new chapter in your life. And the new chapter in your life is this: that we start recognizing the body of Christ. That's going to be the first R today, that we reflect the body of Christ. That's the second R. And then the third one is that we rejoice in the body of Christ, because one of these days you're going to be together with him in heaven, the body of Christ, and it isn't going to be, you know, one group on that side, another group on that side. Actually, there may be some people there surprised to find that you are there, just like you're surprised that they are there. And that it's not my job to who's going to be in or out of the body of Christ. That is God's decision. But that I could appreciate it today, and that I could celebrate it. And so I want to say this about Paul. There's a new chapter, and basically he goes 360. I mean, he just turns around and goes the other direction. He's not persecuting the church now. Now he's preaching Jesus is what he does. And the neat thing about Paul's life, because the day may come as a believer in America, that's what's going to happen. They're going to not like what you say. And this was Paul. I mean, he basically got kicked out of everywhere he went. And some have actually added up the time that he spent in prison. I mean, the time that he was incarcerated for Jesus was about 5 years. And I'm thinking about that because it really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if we feel as if we're incarcerated. It doesn't matter if we feel that we're behind bars. There is this idea that the gospel of Jesus Christ cannot be held. And we are here today celebrating the fact that this is what it is. It is a message. In Galatians chapter 3, verse 28, this was actually Paul's message. He says, there's neither Jew, there's no Greek, there's no slave, there's no free, that there's no male, there's no female, but all of us can be this idea of one in Jesus Christ. And I let that sink in, and I just say how relevant that is, that there is no Jew, there is no Gentile, there is no slave, there is no free, there is no male, there is no female, that all of us have this opportunity to be one in Jesus Christ. Awesome thought. The year, and you know the year, 1963, August the 28th, a young Baptist preacher from Alabama, even though he was born in Atlanta, Georgia, he would stand up and he would borrow the words of the Apostle Paul, which are really the words of Jesus. And he would say this. He says, a day, he said, when all God's children, black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestant and Catholic, will be able to join hands. And that was 58 years ago. Now, whether it was Paul that was saying 2,000 years ago, the body of Christ is one, or whether it was Martin Luther King Jr. and lots of preachers that have preached on this subject, the idea that it is as relevant today in 2022 as it was 58 years ago, it's as relevant today in 2022 as it was 2,000 years ago. And if there isn't one of us that say, well, you know, I've been a little bit guilty when I come to recognize what the body of Christ is, what that means for me as the body of Christ, that maybe what I need today is a new chapter. I need a new chapter in my life. There's another line from that speech. I have a dream speech, and that line goes something like this. Let freedom ring from Stone Mountain, Georgia. And I've always appreciated that because for 5 years, I had the opportunity to be the minister at the Mount Carmel Christian Church in Stone Mountain, Georgia. The church property actually joined the Stone Mountain Park property. If you were baptized in that church, you went up a very long stairway, and there's a very large window so that as you were baptized and you came out of that baptistry, you would look through that big window, and there was. You could see it in its fullness, the Stone Mountain with three Confederate generals on that mountain, carved in that mountain. And so for 5 years, was able to minister at Stone Mountain, Georgia, Mount Carmel Christian Church. Now, it was basically an all-white church trying to reach an all-black community. And out of that, their all-white school that had been started because of desegregation had become an all-black school. And so Monday through Friday, I was the preacher for 200 African-American children. On Sunday, I was the preacher for a medium-aged 60-year-old, 70-year-old white church trying to identify how is it that we connect more in a community in order to show the love of Jesus. I was standing there in the hall at the school one day when Tommy Trone was standing beside me, and one of the young black boys came up to him, looked up to him with those eyes and said, "What was it like, Tommy, when he baptized you?" So I was standing there, so I immediately turned to Tommy and I said, "Tommy, who baptized you?" And Tommy said, "Well, Martin Luther King Jr. baptized me when I was a young boy in Alabama. He came through as a young preacher in a revival, and I went forward and he baptized me." I thought about that because that's always sort of defined where I feel I have been. The idea is that we are in a world, whether it's Jew or Gentile, whether it is slave or free, whether it is male or female, that we have, as messengers of the gospel, we have a responsibility, and more than just a responsibility. Sometimes that brings the idea that I have to do it. No, the privilege of it is this. That we bring a message of the one church, that we not only bring a message of the one church, but that in our hearts, in our minds, we long for a new chapter. And the new chapter is when we recognize what the body of Christ is, and that when we get to heaven, the idea is nobody has to sit on the back row of heaven. The idea is nobody has to give up their seat in heaven for some other person that is deemed more significant. And out of this is the beauty of the oneness. Out of this is the beauty of the unity. And notice the idea that the body, I believe, according to this text, is capable to make visible what is actually invisible. And I say that because when I say that we're the body of Christ today, when I say that we are his hands and his feet and his eyes and his mouth, you say, "Well, I don't really see that in you, Seth. I see that you're human. I see that you're flawed. I see that you make mistakes. I know that. Seth knows that." The other side of that is that there is a little bit of a mystery, the idea of the revelation, and I need that every day, the revelation of what I am. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2 through 5 says this, that I need to be completely humble, I need to be gentle, I need to be patient, I need to be bearing with one another in love, I need to make, and notice the word here, every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace, because there is but one body. and one Spirit, just as you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Make every effort to be the what? To be the, highlighted it for you. I want to make every effort to be this one body in this bond of peace and this bond of unity. Because there's a more important question than who baptized you. There's a more important question than who baptized you. And the more important question is than who baptized you is what happened when you were baptized. And what happened when you were baptized into Christ is that something changed. Now, it may not have changed in your mind. But in God's eyes, there's a change that happens as a husband are united together with his wife, and God's desire that there would never be a divorce. Reality is that divorce happens as much as marriage. But on the other side of that, it is God's plan that the body of Christ, like the marriage, right? Like the marriage, he wants that to succeed. He wants us to realize, to celebrate what this is, and out of that is the beauty of who we are. I need to rush on. The idea then, the metaphor of the body is this, that the head of the body is Christ, and the body of Christ from basically the neck down to the toes is you, right? So you've got that. The head of the body is Christ. And if I put that into the idea that I'm not going to do anything unless my head tells me. I mean, sometimes I'm preaching, my head tells me, shorten the sermon. And then sometimes, no, just preach the sermon. No, shorten the sermon. No, preach the sermon. You know that feeling, Rick. And you say, well, I don't know what I need to do. And I wish it were like that, you know, with my life. Well, my body says this, but my head says this, so that when Jesus says you need to do this, you need to do this. Not because you have to, but because you love him, and the idea is that there needs to be no division. The word in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 25 actually says no division, no friction. He's talking about a unity, and the unity that he talks about isn't this unity and uniformity. I mean, everybody's got to do this. It's the unity in the diversity, meaning that you may be the hand, I may be the ear, you may be the foot, I may be the kidney. The idea is that there's a diversity in that unity, and the great thing is that we can do great things when we recognize who we are. And just to give a applause, I mean, in a few weeks we'll celebrate those that have been married 50 years. And some of you say, hey, point that person out, right? I want to know, what is the secret of staying married for 50 years? Can I just suggest it's this? Start doing the things you did in the beginning to convince her that she should love you anyway. Hold her hand and tell her like 40 times a day that you love her. And don't go to bed angry. That's what the scripture says. You see the beauty of actually being the body of Christ. So that's where we'll start, even though that's where we need to end right now. Recognize the body. Let's start there. Recognize the body of Christ. This is what he says in Ephesians 1, 22 and 23. He says that God has placed under his feet and appointed him to be the head over everything, the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. Paul blows me out of the water. It's like he sits down and he writes this, and it has to be the Holy Spirit, right? Because when he writes this and you try to wrap your head around it, you know, I'm under his feet and he's the head and we're the body and we are the fullness of him who fills everything in every way. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 27 says this, now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you are part of it. It sort of causes me to wonder, maybe I need to re-edit everything I've ever said and just go back and say, was that reflecting the body of Christ? Is that what my head, I am under his feet, I am under his feet, he is the head of my body, does that reflect Jesus? The idea that I'm a family member, that's amazing. The idea that I could be born again into this family, that's amazing. The idea that you, of all people, could be adopted into the body of Christ, that's amazing. Over Christmas time, I had the opportunity to preach my uncle's funeral. He asked me 3 months ago if I would do that. 3 months later, he died, and I did that. And his children, Carl and Mark, came up to me before the service, and they said, we really want you to tell everybody at the service how grateful we were when they decided to adopt us into their family. That's just a physical adoption. I'm trying to put my finger on it. I'm adopted into the body of Christ. I'm adopted into a family. I don't deserve to be here. But I'm adopted into that family. And I appreciate that. I identify this personal relationship that Paul is talking about and then raise my hand and say that I am totally unworthy of that. You know, there are actually some people that try to do this today. They try to change base metal into gold. It can actually be done. Can you imagine living in a world where they can take common lead and turn it into gold? They can do that. But the process of doing it far outweighs the value of the gold, meaning it's so expensive to do it, it doesn't make it beneficial. And then you think about what Jesus did for you, okay? You think about what happened in your life when you were added to the body of Christ and you became part of this family, and you have to ask a question because I do. Do you mean that the value of me being worth him going to the cross and die? I mean, my head says, is it really worth it, Jesus? I'm not worth that much. I'm not that valuable. Why would you do that for me? And yet, according to Scripture, God loved you so much that he sent his only begotten Son into the world, and to identify it today and to recognize it today, that there in Christ, in the Lord, in him, Paul would use that phrase 164 times in his 14 books, I believe. You're in Christ, you're forgiven. You are in the Lord, you are sustained. You are in him, you are saved. If I walk out of here and think that one thing I did for Jesus merits him dying on the cross, then I need to repent because I'm added to his body and I don't deserve that, and I identify that, who I am in Jesus Christ. And then I go to the second part, which is to reflect the body. I grew up, and some of you know this, a preacher's kid, singing the song, every time I turned around, this little light of mine, I'm going to do what? I'm going to let it shine, and I'm not going to let the devil do what? Woo it out. That's what we said in Missouri. I don't know what they say in Virginia, but the idea is I'm going to let it shine, and that idea, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Here's my one purpose in this world, and that is to add value to the body parts, meaning that I'm a part of you, and you're a part of me, and I've never been in a problem situation in my own physical body where my hand said to my brain, I don't want to do that. Actually, every time the brain says for the hand to do something, I'm doing it. It's doing it, right? Because that's what the body does. The body meets the other needs of the body parts under the leadership of the head. You just don't make this stuff up. This is God's picture of the church. And in God's picture of the church, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, he says, imagine a conversation in your body. The conversation in your body, according to Jesus, in 1 Corinthians 12 goes a little bit like this. The eye says to the hand, I don't need you. Now, if my eye actually said to my hand, I don't need you, I wouldn't blame the hand by turning back to the eye and say, I don't need you. The head says to the foot, I don't need you. And if my head actually said to my foot, I don't need you, it wouldn't surprise me that my foot would say back to the head, I don't need you either. The idea is that it's ludicrous that we would ever say to anybody or even think it in the body of Christ, I don't need you. The idea is that I do need you. And the communication of the church has always been this. We do need you. We want to be a loving people, loving Jesus. I've always believed that, because if we're not loving people, then we're not loving Jesus. Because he says, this is how they'll know that you're mine. This is how they'll know that you're part of the body of Christ. And I love the phrase, and it's not original with me, but it's a great quote. It says, live in such a way that those who know you but don't know God will come to know God because, why? Because they know you. Think about it. They don't know God, but they know you. And because they know you, all of a sudden now they get to know God, because when they see you, they hear him, they feel him. You are his body. You reflect him. And then we close on the rejoice part. I don't want to steal at all. In fact, we had a conversation this week. I don't want to steal from next week's sermon on destiny and the hope that you have, that one hope that we have in Jesus Christ. It is powerful. But I do want to get close to it. I'm not going to steal next week's sermon. I want to get close to it, because according to this idea of rejoicing in the one body is the idea that everybody is invited to the party. And I know that maybe you know that, but I just want to remind you that you have already received, I'm assuming, an invitation. If not, I'm going to give one here in a moment. And out of that invitation, everyone is invited to the party. I'll let Rick talk about the party. I want to focus on the everyone's invited in just two or three minutes here. Everybody gets invited to the party. Notice it says in Revelation 19, verse 7 and 8, let us rejoice. I like that. Let us rejoice and let us be glad and let us give him glory. For the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. And fine linen, bright and clean, has been given to her to wear. Rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come. And this wedding of the Lamb, this union of the bride of Christ and the bridegroom Jesus, the body of Christ that is united not just in the head on the earth, but will be united together for eternity, is something that you haven't seen yet, but through the writings of John, you say, wow, what a day that will be, and what a day when we realize that everybody got invited to the party. Now, not everybody responded to the party, but everybody got invited to the party. Even a man by the name of Saul. Even by a man who stood there and smiled while Stephen was being killed. You might feel a little bit when he says, I of all people don't deserve it. But then said it this way, I'd be glad to go to hell for you. Really, Paul? Yeah, because of what's at stake. Do you know what's at stake? Eternity. And praise God at the leading of Ananias. Get up. What are you waiting for, Saul? Be baptized. Wash away your sins. That Saul took off the coat of Saul and put on the coat of Jesus. Pure, white, forgiven. Guess what? Everybody gets invited to the party. Blessed are those, in verse 9, those who are invited to the wedding supper of the Lamb, the bride beautiful. And who is this bride beautiful? Paul devotes most of the book of Ephesians on this subject. Who's been invited? You see, before the cross, it was the Jews. The word Jew comes from Judah, the family tree of Abraham. They were the farmers. They were preparing and plowing the field for the seed of a special divine revelation of a baby that was going to be born in a promised land, and that baby's name was Jesus. And they worked the ground in a holy nation, in a moral and a religious purity that most of us know nothing about keeping, but the idea that he's coming before the cross. After the cross, things change. After the cross, the two groups become one. Ephesians 5, verse 32. No longer is God's message exclusive. Now it is inclusive. Joel the prophet would say, I will pour out my spirit on all people. And then to say this, that was a mystery then. For Peter, who stood up in Acts chapter 2, quoted Joel and said, this is what is happening. God's pouring out his spirit. And even though he struggled with it, even he and Paul had a conversation about it. There is no dividing line. There is no wall between. There is no Jew, no Gentile, no slave, nor free, nor man or woman, but all are one in Jesus Christ. And we are getting ready for a party. The scripture says this, Matthew 22. At the wedding banquet, it says, go to the street corners and invite into the banquet. Anyone will come. Anyone that will come, invited to the banquet. I like that anyone clause. Because when you read it in Luke 14, 21, the anyone basically means everybody's invited. And then Jesus himself, his own mouth, his own intention for his own body, the church, gives us the list. Invite the poor. Invite the crippled. Invite the blind. Invite the lame. Go to the roads, Jesus said, and go to the country roads, which means that rednecks can get to heaven as well, Everybody is invited to the party. How beautiful is the body of Christ. And as we close today with this invitation concerning the body of Christ, and as we share in communion the body of Christ, let us not forget Paul's words. You are the body of Christ. It's worth exploring. It's also worth asking the question, why? Because that's how much he loves you. Behold, the bridegroom comes, is the voice you'll hear. I believe even now the wedding party is being assembled in heaven. The white horse is being readied. I wouldn't doubt if the saddle is already on it. The rider, it says his eyes are like burning fire. On his head are many crowns. He is dressed in a robe that is dipped in blood. The armies of the heaven are following him. He is dressed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth, a sharp sword. And on his robe and on his thigh are written, King of kings and Lord of lords. For behold, your bridegroom comes. Revelation 22. The Spirit and the bride say, come. And whoever is thirsty, let him come. Whoever wishes, let him come and take of that gift of the water of life. And you've never surrendered your life to Christ. You've never met him in the water grave of baptism. It's not who baptized you. It's what happened when you were baptized. We are the body of Christ, period. This is his house, not the building, this body. It honors the head. The head will always be Jesus. And the surrender of our life, though I don't know why, evidently, is worth the gift of his only begotten Son, that he would love me that much. I sang another song when I was a kid. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. And I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. And he takes me by the hand. He leads me through the promised land. What a day, what a glorious day that will be. I'll be looking for you. I hope you'll be looking for me. It means more, doesn't it? Just pick it up. There it is, the body. Little confession. I was in the back and I laid this on a shelf, and so halfway through the first song I had to go back and get the body. You ever do that? You ever forget the body? If you have a decision today, I'll be down front just to acknowledge that. The decision now is, do I fathom the body of Christ, of which we are? Let's pray. Thank you, God, for the opportunity to be together as the body. Thank you, Father, that I didn't add myself and somebody else didn't add me. You added me through your grace and the blood of Jesus. And as we celebrate the blood of Christ now, Father, and as we break this bread, his body, though, Father, we understand metaphors, may it go into the mystery as we take it together, one body, anticipating the bridegroom. And in this, Father, we celebrate. In Jesus' name, amen.
sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, O sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can heal.
So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. All who are broken, lift up your face.
People said amen. I'm going to let you take a real quick seat for a second and introduce a young man before we go on to our closing. Luke has come up to say that he has been around Fairmount for a while and really realized, hey, I need to be a part of this family, in the sense of the fact that he was baptized when he was 12 years old in all places, Port-au-Prince, Haiti, and has been a part of this family, especially with the Collies, since you were age...
Five
years old, being able to do school in America, and is now a junior, and wouldn't be surprised that maybe there's another preacher in the work. I'm not going to put that pressure on you, but I've got a book that says if you want to preach, and there's a lot behind that phrase. But Luke's dad is a preacher in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, with his mom and a sister, and comes today just to say, not only have I been a part of this body of believers, the body of Christ, but I recognize that today formally, that I really want to be a part of this body here at Fairmount Christian Church. So let's give Luke a hand. Say thank you, Luke, for making that decision. Now, he just said thank you to me. It's really thank you to him, right? Right. That you would love us so that we could learn, as we do, love each other. Luke, I'm going to ask you that question that you answered when you were 12 years old. Baptized, you said, by an elder in the church in Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, your personal Lord and Savior? And have you put on Christ through Christian baptism? And do you serve him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
God bless you for making that decision. And God bless you and welcome to Fairmount. Let's say this together. We believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, our personal Lord and Savior. And based on that is the beauty of the body of Christ, of which we are. And welcome, Luke, and we'll be glad to send word back to mom and dad and your sister how precious it is to have you here with us at Fairmount. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of your love and the gift of your grace. We thank you, God, that when we didn't deserve it, you demonstrated it by sending Jesus. And Father, when we think about the depth of your love and the height of your love and the width of your love, and to imagine, as Paul says, that it is without measure, we pray that you will guide us so that we will not measure your love. But Father, we will demonstrate to this world that we live in that there is neither Jew nor Greek, nor Gentile, nor slave nor free, nor male or female, but Father, that all of us get to be one in Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, for Luke and for the seeds that were sown far away on a land that still, like America, needs the light of Jesus. We thank you for his mother and father. We thank you for his sister. We thank you, Father, that in the gospel of Jesus Christ, though it has not come full circle yet, that we rejoice not only in Luke's confession, but also, Father, the opportunity to welcome him here. We pray, Father, that as we reflect upon your welcome of us in your family, that we will welcome Luke and we will celebrate as we look forward to the wedding feast of the Lamb, in Jesus' name. And all the people said, amen. Let's be standing. Let's go to this last song.
Fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. My praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed with water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father, our God. We'll finish what he started. Yes, our God will finish what he started. Yeah. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous,
I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony.
Amen. God bless you and have a wonderful week. We'll see you back here next Sunday.